support system. When parents, husbands, and other family members cannot cope with a voice hearer, they go to a doctor. And often the doctor is trained to diagnose hearing voices as a symptom of an illness. Research showed that if a person told a doctor that he heard voices, there's an 80% chance that he or she gets a diagnosis of schizophrenia. And in my children's research, I've often seen children which, if the psychiatrist saw the child, he would take it into the hospital. But the mother could cope with the child, and it was fantastic. I know those children for more than 10 years, and I see them develop, and they cope well now. So they were very lucky to have a mother who could support them in that difficult time. Voice hearers, learned me a different story. A story I saw confirmed in our research. I've been working with adult voice hearers for over 30 years, with children since 1993. I interviewed over 300 people, voice hearing. From the beginning, I worked with patients and non-patients. Although in the last decennium of the previous era, population surveys showed that hearing voices is apparent in a normal population, looking at the number of publications, only recently there is a growing acceptance of this fact. But the consequence of a change, consequence in the attitude of towards voice hearers, that hearing voices is not an illness but a human variation, I still miss. Had the mental care, healthcare doesn't take the consequence that voice hearing in itself is a normal human variation. Most research focuses on the voices from the medical attitude, looking to phenomenological elements of the voices. Researchers' brain scans shows that several centers of the brains are activated when hearing voices. Research of such as from Professor Sommers in Utrecht, Holland, showed that there is no difference in the characteristics of the voices. And this is important. There are there is not such a thing as a pathological voice. I come to the differences later. In spite of all the new technology and respect to the enormous amount of work that's done, we still wonder how helpful this information is for voice hearers. We rely too much on large-scale models with chance predictions. It looks as if we forgot that voices only have one thing in common, such as being a voice. Voices might be pleasant or threatening, and we saw that in patients and in non-patients in about 45%, but each voice has its own way. Each voice hearer experiences the voices as unique, as well as every voice is unique. Then there is the important question again, what helps the voice hearer? Does it help the voice hearer to know that his brain is activated? He doesn't have to prove it for himself. From him, it's important to learn to cope with the emotions the voices evoke, like anxiety, meaning, the meaning of the voices, and what they say, and the powerlessness, and also the inspiration, the positive side, because sometimes it's also difficult to learn to cope with inspiration. For him, the voice hearer, it's important to know which meaning, as we say, which message the voices have in his or her life. What the meaning is, voices, as we now know, are a reaction often provoked by trauma to emotions people cannot cope with. Each voice hearer reacts to problems of a trauma in his own way. Therefore, I think it's important to gather more knowledge on individuals' level. On individual level, instead of refining our diagnostic categories. Then there's the fact that many people, adults and children who hear voices, don't feel the need for care. That's the other side. They can cope with them. As long as we overlook this fact and approach the voices from a psychological point of view, we will keep those people framed in an illness model. Better said, we will create the illness, we will create the patients. And to answer the question further of the differences, I look at my own research. I conducted a 3-year follow-up study and found a bit the same results as are found now, and it was in 2003. In the differences in, before I forget, the differences that was found in Summers' research was the frequency yet age at the onset, emotional valence of the content associated with the stress and degree of control individuals experience. That was different in non-patients. In our research, we had as inclusion criteria, voices must have the characteristics of auditory hallucinations. Voices must be heard at least during daytime with full consciousness. Voices must be heard at least half a year. I say this because most people think that the characteristics that they say that the non-patients, they only hear voices during nighttime or so. They always reason away from that fact, and that makes me angry often. As a research instrument, we used the Maastricht interview for children, the brief psychiatric grading scale, the dissociative experience scale, the youth self-report, and the children's global assessment scale. Well, we're very lucky. We went to the media to get the children. And as you can see, we divided them in three groups. And as you can see, we had a little bit more older children who were patients and a bit younger children who were non-patients. But the average was about the same age. And boys and girls, we were lucky there also. We had about as much girls as much boys. A little bit more girls in the older age group. We found no statistical difference in the experience of patients and non-patients. And what we also found was being in care had no influence on the continuation or discontinuation of the voices. So that is something. But what we saw on individual level, that the therapist, the relation with the therapist had influence. Trauma. Well, we found, as in adults, we found a high percentage of trauma in children. 85% of the children related the onset of voice hearing to some kind of trauma. And it was the incapability to cope with emotions related to trauma that made the problem. Voices come instead of trauma. And in our research, we had a lot of children who were confrontation with the death of a grandmother or a friend or family member that set the voices on. Problems around the home situation, like divorce was a problem, set the voices on. Rows with the siblings, moving houses, problems around the school situation, that was when the children couldn't cope with the material, with what they had to learn in school, and when that they went to a school on a lower level, the voices disappeared and they couldn't cope. Bullying, of course, was a big problem, but now some more research has been done in this field. And then we saw other kind of trauma, which was also sexual abuse, but sexual abuse was underrated in our research because the parents telephoned, and if you sexually abuse your child, you don't telephone me to participate in my research. It was also children who were sick, were severely sick, and were in a ward where other children died who started to hear voices. And there were two children who had, with their birth, they didn't have enough oxygen, so they had brain damage. But they started to hear voices when they realized that they were not anymore at the same level as their peers when they went to school. And that gave a lot of aggression and voices. Yeah. So being in care had no influence on the cause. And 60% of the children lost the voices during the research period. So that was a very positive outcome. And therefore, I dare to say things like, give some space, but I will go into that later. If we look at the research instruments, then we see the difference between the patient and non-patient was a high score on BPRS on anxiety, depression, frequency of the voices, negative symptoms, death. On dissociation, there was a higher score with patients, and the youth self-report was a total higher score, so there was more social dysfunctioning. was fantastic, the youth self-report. The children were so honest, because before you do the interview, you have to have a relation, and the child has to trust you. And then when I asked on the self-report, questions like, do you ever steal? Yes, they said enthusiastically. Do you ever lie? Yes. They were so honest, you know. Fantastic. It was a real joy to work with them. How long do you think this interview is going to last? And I said, well, it depends on your answers. Yes, don't tell my mother, but I have a date and I need to go away in half an hour. Are the differences another between patients and non-patients? There we see that patients reported more emotional triggers. Patients reported more emotional appraisal. The emotional appraisal was more often negative. Voices influenced their behavior more. There were more positive, passive problem solving, and children with aggressive behavior were more often in care. Huh? And as a child, if you don't open your mouth, they think everything is okay with you. But especially the children who were very quiet, they were more problematic than the children who were angry, because if you are angry, you want to change, you can work with those children. But the children who shut down and don't say anything, that's the problematic group, I think. Well, all these five elements indicate that there's a problem on individual level in coping with emotions. And that is something we can do be given attention in therapy. So it's not the illness, but learning to cope with the problem. In our research, patients reported more traumatic events, one or more traumatic events. And also there you can work in therapy with. Well, if I had my saying, if someone would ask me, like they have asked Peter, what would be ideal for you? I think that based on my experience with the children over the last 20 years, I would advise a non-medical start. Very early intervention. As soon as the child starts to hear voices, it should be go to or the parents should know not a medical hospital, but maybe a self-help group or voice hearers who interview the child with the semi-structured interview, for example, the Maastricht interview. And wait a minute, because we wanted that very early intervention to keep them out of hands of psychiatry. Let the system get its own power. As hearing voices is apparent in the normal population, it hardly can be seen as an illness. So take the consequence and don't make it an illness by going to a doctor too soon. I would strongly advise if children or parents look for help to normalize the experience. I've caught quite a lot of telephones by mothers who were so afraid, and I said, well, it's normal, but you have to believe it, because if you are afraid of the voices, you transfer this to your child. So I send them literature, and they could ask me questions about it, and that helped. And then helps also if you are working at the university. If the university says it's not an illness, then it might be true. So that's helpful. Well, we use the semi-structured interview in the first meeting to map the voices, like in the Maastricht interview, like the characteristics, the triggers, the content. Interview the child in the presence of the parents. I think that's very important, because the parents learn to understand the behavior of the child better. For example, I asked one child, do the voices ever forbid you to do things? And then she overlooked me and said to her father, yeah, therefore I couldn't play chess with you yesterday. The voices forbade me to do it. But she hadn't dared to tell it to her father directly. The next year, I found that the family is much more open. When the voices forbid something, the child can say to her father, but the voices forbidden me. So it's very good that the parents understand more the behavior of the child. Does it complicate the relation? And you can look together for different solutions. Well, do the interview. And if you are, give your telephone number for the questions, also as a voice here, you can do that. and let the child and parents find their own resources. And that's what I saw and promote very much in my children's research. Parents and children do find their own resources, given the space. But if you move in too quickly with all your medication or your therapy, then you don't allow them to find it out themselves. Remember, when you were a child, you also wanted to fall on your own nose. You don't want your mother to prevent it. You want to find your own way in life. And it's with the voices the same. It's no different. If you want more control, you can ask the child to keep a diary. And if after half a year or 3 months, the voices are still the problem, explore together the experience and learn to understand the triggers and the emotions. Give the children a language for their experience. And I learned that it was very important for the children that they could, that they had a language in which they could express themselves. And that language is not there. They have, when they hear voices, they meet with the psychiatric language. Well, which voice here, child voice here, hears auditory hallucinations? No one, they hear voices. So be sure that you give them a language. They will have to learn to accept that the voices are part of them. If they are part of you, then they don't fight them, because that's the problem. If you start fighting the voices mostly win. They don't have to be afraid of them, as they are mostly messages. So try to find out the message and don't kill the messenger. It's true that voices must be controlled. In our research, this approach worked. Because after the research also, I interviewed quite a few children when parents telephoned me and I invited them. And I saw also that worked, not interfering, but let the parents ask the questions, let the parents decide when they needed help again. In the first year of our research, 80% of the children were afraid of the voices. And by explaining, we saw that in the second year, only 40%. In the second year, we saw also an enormous reduction in the problems at home and at school. And one of the mothers said, "He's one of my children now. He's not the child with the voices." And that's what we want. The voices are not symptoms of an illness, but a reaction, have a relation with the life history. As we found, 85% of the children began to hear voices in relation to trauma or problematic situations. We began to look to a relation between the voices and the life history. In the interviews, we found five elements that will give information about the relations. And those five elements are the onset of the voice hearing. It will give away what's the problem. The characteristics of the voices, like tone, gender, will give information about the abusers or the problem. The content, the triggers, what triggers the voices. In children, we saw if the voices are triggered at school, then mostly the problem is at school. So the situation is very important. And certain emotions, like anxiety, anger. I know quite a few children who couldn't cope with anger, and one of the boys learned it from his teacher. He had the idea that if he got angry, that he would be so strong that he would kill someone. So he never dared to be angry. And at a certain moment, one of his peers made him angry. And his teacher saw it, and he said to both boys, "Come here, what's happening?" And they had to explain to him what had happened. And then he said, "Well, you have to agree on something." And they started to talk and agreed on something, shake hands. And then the teacher said, "You have to keep to the agreement." And the boy did. And he in this way, he found a way to cope with his aggression. He was lucky that he learned it by his teacher. But there are many ways to learn to cope with aggression if it's recognized as a problem. You don't need medication to learn to cope with aggression. You need doing it. You need wise people. Did I lose? Yes, what we saw was very helpful. We saw that the children during the research developed, and we made a developmental scale to measure it. And what was very important was acquiring more friends at peer level. Development is disturbed by medication, by psychiatry, so be sure that there is an opening. Look at the development of children. Knowing better what they wanted to become in life was one thing that we saw that had to do with development. Coping better with emotions, having fewer conflicts within family and at school, and a positive report on development by child and or parents. So if they said, yes, I think I developed that better, so that we saw them. And then we looked, is discontinuation of the voices the most important goal? If we look at the development of the children during our research, we saw that a positive development, oh yeah, if the scale, if 3 out of 5 was positive, then we said it was a positive development. Positive development, there you see continuation of the voices, only 7 children, discontinuation, 37 children. And a negative development, continuation of the voices, 15 children, so it's twice as much, and discontinuation of the voices, 8 children. There you see. So it's very important to focus development. I found myself good that I learned to do that. But thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sandra.